All right. Thanks very much. Thanks to AGI and the other sponsors. I'm going to talk a little bit about some long-term planning issues for resilience around our maritime infrastructure and how we use the geosciences in that planning and design process. So I'm a professor at the University of Rhode Island in the Department of Marine Affairs, and my subject area is seaports and the maritime transportation system. And I focus on this area because I find ports and maritime transportation to be a very interesting case study for these three reasons in particular. First of all, ports are critical infrastructure on a local, national, and a global scale. In the U.S., we have about 23 million jobs that are port-related. Around 99% of the volume of U.S. trade, overseas trade, goes through ports. So, if you think about the objects in the room that you're in, the computer screens, your telephones, and just kind of conceptualize that all of these things that we use every day have passed through at least two ports, one, on their way out of their country of origin and one on their way in. So they're very important infrastructure. They're very complex infrastructure. So ports are often a combination of public and privately managed and owned and operated. They have lots and lots of different stakeholders, from the port authorities themselves to the shippers and the truckers that are using the ports to the general public that's depending on them for their economic value. And they're very long-lasting infrastructure. So if you go down to any port in the world, you will often see piers and berths that were constructed over 100 years ago still in serviceable condition today. And finally, ports are very constrained to these very specific locations. They need access to deep water. They need access to other kinds of infrastructure. They need some amount of protection from the elements. And this often puts them in very environmentally sensitive locations in our estuaries, where the oceans meet the rivers, and these make for excellent places to transport cargo from one country to another, and then inland through our riverine systems. But these estuary areas are also critical breeding grounds for marine life, which means that ports are facilitating the transport of hundreds of thousands of tons of hazardous materials through our most environmentally sensitive areas. So they're very interesting to study and very important. The demand for port uses is only going to increase as we go ahead into the next several decades. This graph just shows a projection for global population and overlaid over a projection for seaborne trade. And going from 2020 to 2050, we're expecting potentially a tripling of seaborne trade, which means that the demand for these very valuable coastal lands is only going to go up. So my particular area of focus is on coastal resilience, and ports are already at risk from many natural hazards, in particular tropical storms. This map just shows about a third of the world's ports. There's about 4,000 or so ports in the world that have come within 50 kilometers of a tropical storm in the last 50 or so years. So they're already at risk from these kinds of storm events. And these kinds of challenges are likely to increase with climate change. By the end of the century, some scientists are expecting a doubling of the strong Category 4 and 5 tropical storms. Of course, sea level rise, which the projections are anywhere from 3/4 of a meter to 2 meters or even more now, is the latest extreme NOAA projections, and then inland flooding events. And if you take these three drivers and bring them together, as some scientists have for the North Atlantic region, we find that what is today the 1-in-100-year storm event could be as frequent as the 1-in-3-year storm event by 2100. So that means big challenges for our coastal infrastructure going forward. So how do geo and ocean sciences inform planning? I'm just going to give you a few examples here of studies that we've been doing that are using geo and ocean sciences for long-term resilience thinking and resilience planning. So first, geo and ocean sciences help us to understand what the risks are. So we, in this example, we're looking at a visualization of a storm impact that brings together some scenarios around climate projections around storms and impacts that are expected from actual facility managers on the ground, and results in a visualization to help people understand and engage in a very complex problem. Here's a couple more examples that are just showing some other ways that we use some of these ocean models to visualize what we can expect from different kinds of storm events. And these are all examples from Rhode Island, and on the upper right and the lower left, we're looking at the Port of Providence in Rhode Island and what the expected storm surge would be from one particular extreme hurricane event. And this is a way for decision makers and owners of private firms in this industrial area to better understand what to expect so that they can begin to prepare and do long-term planning. Second, we can use geo and ocean sciences to help us understand the construction and design aspects. So these are just a few examples of some of the data that are input into various models and scenarios to help understand if we're thinking about a big picture resilience strategy, such as one of these three of protecting by designing a new storm barrier, like the one in the Netherlands there that you see on the left, elevating our infrastructure as was being considered for the Port of Gulfport, or simply designing the existing infrastructure so that it can be submerged. These different data points that you see on the list there are critical for understanding which of these different options to select, and then what the actual design considerations should be if and when you choose one. And then lastly, you know, when we're thinking about improving our coastal infrastructure in the coming decades or coming century, we need to think about not only what will happen on our individual project, but what the aggregate impact of many of these projects being done along the same timeline might be. So we've done a couple of thought exercises here to generate some preliminary kind of order of magnitude estimates of what the resource requirements might be to protect many, in this case, seaports, but you know, if we're thinking about our coastal areas, we will eventually need to protect our seaports, our airports, our power plants, and our coastal communities in some areas. But we did this just a pilot project to understand how much would it take in terms of materials to protect just 221 of the world's largest seaports. And we found, we looked at concrete and aggregate and stone and sand, and found that about 143 million cubic meters of concrete would be required just to protect the seaports using a coastal protection structure. Similarly, one of the other options might be to elevate some of our coastal infrastructure to get it up and out of the new floodplain. And so we did some thought exercises around the cost to elevate the U.S. ports up to 2 meters to get them out of that new floodplain that is projected for the upper bound of sea level rise by 2100, and found that in aggregate, projects on that size to protect all 100 ports would cost somewhere between $64 and $85 billion, and we did that by region there. So that's just a couple of examples. We rely heavily on geo and ocean sciences for a whole variety of reasons. They help us understand what the context is, both locally and nationally, in terms of the risks from various natural hazard events. They can help us to engage stakeholders, for example, with those visualizations to help people really understand what the problem might be for them, and to find consensus around what option a community might want to follow in order to build a resilient infrastructure going forward and to design wisely for these future conditions that we're expecting. So I will end there, and I guess we're going to go to questions now.